Welcome to Cavalry Christian Center. We are a family-friendly church that teaches the Word of God under the leadership of Drs. Philip and Brenda Godeau. This is where the Word works when you work the Word.
All the different murders, rapes, tortures, beheadings, imprisonment, just goes on and on. Somewhere, hear me now, somewhere the church has to rise up. Somewhere the church has to quit being complacent, mediocre, milquetoast, and mealy-mouthed and start standing up for what is right and righteous. Listen to me. The tragedy is going on all around the world because of our faith, because the gospel is the only pill for every ill, is the gospel. And the war is against the gospel, against the blood of Jesus Christ, against the redemptive power that God can bring into a person's life and totally turn them around. Now, how many of y'all's lives have been totally turned around because of Jesus Christ? Amen? I mean absolutely turned around. My wife says that I'm the greatest miracle she's ever seen. Because of what God did in my life, because I was sure enough a heathen, and I was not trying to be nothing but that. But God got a hold of me and turned my life around, and I'm thankful for it. Amen. And now I'm trying to do everything I can to help everybody I can to turn their lives around also. So I know I'm a threat to the kingdom of darkness. So if the devil, see, the problem is what's going on in Europe, what's going on in Africa, Asia, all around the world, is that nobody is standing up. Our government is not standing up. Nobody, the churches are not standing up for the Christians that are being beheaded and murdered and just slaughtered and kicked, being everything stolen from them. Nobody is standing up like they should. So I thank God for John and his team and those that are standing up in that area. And when this was given to me, I said, man, of course, this is down my alley. This is what I've been looking for. I want to stand up. I want to be a voice that speaks to this nation and the world that we got to understand that if we don't stand up, then we're going to end up being the victims ourselves. Because if you don't know it right now, things are shifting, and they're not shifting in our favor. Our politicians are anti-God almost, they want to even, our own government is saying now that we're not a Christian nation no more because they don't want to recognize us being a Christian nation. But when people come here from different countries, they come here because they say this is a Christian nation. They recognize it. But what a shame when our own government wants to say that it's not a Christian nation anymore. I still confess that this is a Christian nation. I still confess that God is still God of America and that Jesus is Lord over all. Amen. That's my confession, and that's where I'm going to stand. But see, I was raised a little different when I came up as a kid. You know, we used to do prayer. We had prayer in school. We pledged allegiance to the flag. Come on, anybody know what I'm talking about? Nowadays, it's like something the matter with you. If you have any kind of dedication or a commitment to this country or to God, that everything, that you are some kind of freak or something the matter with you. Or if you stand for righteousness in any kind of way, stand for any kind of Judeo-Christian values, like for family, for education, for anything along that line, then you're being attacked as a hate monger. But I declare today that Jesus is Lord. Yes. And I declare that this country, because of us right here, and everything is getting ready to start shifting in the right direction. Amen. So in the book of Hebrews, look with me in Hebrews, the 13th chapter in verse 2, it says, remember, somebody shout out, remember. Amen. Remember them, so you need to underline remember and circle the word them. Underline remember and circle the word them. Remember them that are in what? Bonds. Now, real quickly, somebody tell me, you got to shout out because I got to hear you. What does the word bonds mean? What? Prisoner. What? Hostage. What? Bondage. Imprison. Chained. What is it? Okay, I tell you what. So we got some here, and what we understand is that it's something that is not what you're supposed to be in. Okay? You're not supposed to be in prison unless you are a lawbreaker. Amen. But as a Christian, we ain't supposed to be in prison. That's not what we're supposed to be. We're not supposed to be in bondage. We're not supposed to be in chains. We're not supposed to be restricted. But it says here, remember, come on, y'all, come on, remember who? Them. Who? Them who are in what? Bondage. Remember those that are in bondage, and it says, and as what? Bound with them. And it says, them which suffer adversities as being yourselves also in the body. That those that are in adversity, that we should be suffering or carrying the same pain. When my brother or sister hurt, it doesn't matter what denomination they in. It's just that they have accepted Christ in life. They are trying to live for God. That when they hurt, we should hurt. Come on, talk to me over here. They should. When they hurt, we hurt. Is that right? When they go through something, we go through something. Because we're all bound together through the blood of Jesus Christ as brothers and sisters. No matter what your denomination is, we're bound together. And we should understand that. And listen to me. They're not just killing, Pentecostal Christians. They're killing every Christian. Everyone. I was watching not that long ago where they got a great flood of immigrants coming from Africa trying to go to Italy. And then they all these boats that's overpacked. And then they go in there and they get them out to the ocean and find out how many of you are Christians, or start asking them or going through whatever they do. And then when they find out they're Christian, they throw them overboard, drown them. Thousands of them have drowned on that area. We're not talking about Boko Haram in Nigeria, Africa, where it is bringing terror throughout there. The 300 school kid girls that they kidnap, raping, putting them into sex trafficking, and all the murders that are going on. We're not talking about the Taliban over in dealing with Afghanistan and all the other places where they're attacking. There's so much going on. And there's so much quietness concerning the area of the attacks against the Christian church. And see, I truly believe that our government should be standing up for it. And it's amazing that we'll stand up, our government will stand up for everything else except for the Christian. And what made this nation great is God himself. There is no other like Jehovah. But the enemy's warring against the Christian to keep you quiet and worried about you, about being attacked by the IRS or somebody, whatever the case is. But you can't be intimidated by nobody. Listen to me, God on our side is greater than anything against us. All right, okay. So it says here that we remember those that are being bound in this adversary, this enemy is working against them. So look with me in the book of 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles, and we're going to share some scriptures here with you today. 2 Chronicles, the 16th chapter. And look what it says here, because we need to understand this, and I want you to write it down and get it down. 2 Chronicles 16th chapter and verse 9 says, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the what? Don't you underline that? Throughout the whole earth, to show himself what? Strong on the behalf of those whose hearts is what? Perfect towards him. Do I have anybody like that today? I'm going to say that again. Do I have anybody like that today? Okay, forget y'all. I'm going to go over here then. I'm standing in front of you. I know y'all trying to still find the scripture. Do I got anybody like that today? Yes. Whose heart is perfect before him? Whose heart is perfect towards him? In other words, is your heart committed to serving him and honoring him is your heart. The word heart there means to be clean. The word heart there, perfect. The word perfect means to be pure, clean, upright, complete, or devoted. Now Moffat, who has a Moffat translation, says that the eternal eyes dart here and dart there and all over the whole world to exert his power on the behalf of those who are devoted to him. Do I got any devoted people in here to him? In other words, whatever you're going through, God says, I'm going here and there. I'm looking all around because I want to show and exert my power on your behalf. I don't know about y'all, but I receive that in Jesus' name. So no matter what you're dealing with, what you're going through, what's going on in your life, God wants to exert his power on your behalf. Because how many of y'all know when God delivers you out of whatever you've been going through, then God gets the glory out of it. Is that right? I'm praying for every one of you in here today and you watching by television, the internet. I'm praying for deliverance in this house today. I'm praying for breakthrough on your behalf today. I'm praying that God's miracle working power is working on your behalf. Listen to me right now. God is working on your behalf in this service right now. You know why? Because I'm praying for his miracle working power on your behalf. Glory to God. I'm believing that you're going to say, man, I went to that church over there and man, something happened in there. And when I got, by the time you got home, something already then broke open on your behalf. To exert his power, God's power on your behalf. How many of y'all receive that? Man, I'm going to raise both my hands. I receive God's power to be exerted on my behalf. See, the problem with some of us, a lot of time, we don't understand that we need to be able to make a commitment to being able to help. Look at me in Isaiah 59. See, when God wants to exert his power, sometimes we're not able to get God's power exerted on our behalf because we're so overwhelmed with ourselves. Now, there's two areas that we overexerting ourselves or overwhelmed with the area of ourselves, and one of them is just plain selfishness, and the second one is just area of that you are overwhelmed with yourself behind your circumstances you're dealing with. Any of y'all ever had any real bad tragedies happen in your life? I mean, where you got overwhelmed. Come on, I'm talking to y'all. Where you got overwhelmed. Anybody that's been really overwhelmed with a bad situation in your life? Yes. You know, one time when my wife, on our first child, our baby, Kamitra, and Brenda and I were sitting in the house, and I was getting ready to go to work for double time and a half or triple time and a half. I was excited about that money. Amen. I was going to go to work, make that money. But my wife and I had been taking Lamaze courses. So we're getting ready. And so I decided, but it must have been the Spirit of God. I said, before I go to work, I'm just going to put my hand on your stomach, see if you're in having any contractions. Just plan. But it was God. You know, God knows how to lead. Okay, I'm on the wrong side. Anyway, do y'all know what I'm talking about? And I went in there and laid my hands on Brenda, and guess what? She was in contractions. And not only in contractions, but she was in contractions with 5 minutes apart. I said, honey, you got contractions going on right now. Oh no, I don't. I'm all right. Ain't nothing going on. I said, no, you got contractions going on. And then I called the doctor. Guess what happened? The doctor answered the phone. Now, I mean, you know, that's a miracle right there. The doctor answered the phone. That was a miracle. When he answered the phone, I said, Doc, I laid hands on my wife. I put my hands on, and my wife is in contraction, and they're 5 minutes apart. He said, bring her in. I said, Brenda, he said, bring her in. She said, no, I'm not going in. You know, I'm all right. I said, Doc, she said, she all right. And he said, bring her in. I said, Brenda, he said to bring you in. Brenda said, no, I'm all right. I'm cool. And I said, Doc, he said, she's all right. She's not coming in. And he said, bring her in! I said, Brenda, get up. We're going to the doctor right now. Amen. Got her to the doctor. And they started checking her out. He said she'd been in contractions for 12 hours. It was 12 hours. She was in contractions for 12 hours and didn't even know it because the baby was breached, coming out butt first. And so it didn't push against the pelvis or whatever it is. Whatever that thing, uterus. It didn't push right. Amen. And so she didn't even know she was in it. 12 hours. Now it was starting to shrink back. And now the doctor told me, said, we got some real bad news. Said, basically, your wife needs surgery. We have no surgery teams here. We got to, you're going to lose your wife or the baby. And I got overwhelmed. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about. I got so overwhelmed, I couldn't remember nobody's phone number. It was just me, and I was so overwhelmed. And then I'm trying to be a tough dude, and tears are just coming out my eyes. I can't stop my eyes from watering. I'm trying to stop from crying, and my wife is laying there, and she needs my support, and she don't even know how bad a shape she's in, and that now they talk about me losing either her or the baby or both of them. And I went in the back room, and I just cried. I mean, I tried to get as much crying out as I could real fast. Try to rush to cry. Because I can't stop from crying, so I'm going to rush to cry. Y'all don't know what I'm talking about. I'm rushing that cry. Then I clean myself up, walk back out there, Brenda laying on the thing. And she said, everything all right, Phil? I said, oh, yeah, everything all right. Excuse me for a minute, though. Went back in there and cried some more. And I don't know how long. I couldn't remember nobody. No, I was just going through it. I was just overwhelmed. That's what I'm talking about. Just being overwhelmed. Tell you the rest of the story that I don't know how long we were in the hospital, but the doctor ended up coming saying a miracle happened. Because I couldn't even pray. I know that sounds really shocking, but I couldn't even pray. I was so overwhelmed. I couldn't remember prayers. I couldn't remember numbers. I just cried, Jesus. And, you know, just Jesus. Anybody know him? Jesus. Just Jesus. And then the doctor came in there, and then he said, Mr. Godot, he said, a miracle happened. This, we had an operation going on, and it ended up quicker than they expected. The team right now, I've been getting chills all over me right now. The team is getting ready to help get your wife. You're still probably going to lose one or the other, but we can probably save one of them. So if you had to come to a decision, which one are you going to save? Jesus! I want both of them. And thank God for his mercy and grace. His name is Jehovah Hasid, a loving and merciful God. And he showed up on the behalf of me when I couldn't even pray. I didn't know what to do. God showed up. But I was overwhelmed. What I needed right then and what happened is that I needed somebody to pray for me. I don't know if you've ever been in that place where that you couldn't pray yourself, but you needed somebody to pray for you. Thank God for men and women that will see when we're going through something or know something that will pray for us. Are you with me? When I was in that car accident and I was told I was paralyzed from my waist down and I was knocked unconscious. The guy took me in, when they rushed me in and put me into the x-ray thing to see what was going on, the x-ray technician, all I remember, and I was going in and out, and I remember him putting his hands, and I could hear him praying, but I didn't know what he prayed for. All I know is when I came out of from what they were, when I couldn't move my legs, all I know is that I came out and that the paralysis had just disappeared. Amen. So in the book of Isaiah, in Isaiah 59, Isaiah 59. And when you get to Isaiah 59, then push your neighbor and tell him it's a miracle getting ready to happen in your life. Come on, tell him, believe with me right now. Believe with me that you're in a miracle service. Something getting ready to happen for you in Jesus' name. No, you're in the right place right now. Glory to God. Isaiah 59, look what it says in Isaiah 59 and verse 19. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the what? Come on, everybody, from the what? From the west. Where are you right now? And I declare that this is the beginning of something great in the West that's going to spread all around, that there's going to be an awakening and an outpouring of God's presence upon the body of Christ to be able to start standing on the behalf of those that are out there that are hurting, our brothers and sisters, that God is going to be able to intervene on their behalf because of our stand for them in Jesus' name. How many of y'all believe that when you pray, something happens? The Bible says the effectual, fervent prayers of a righteous man or woman availeth much. And I declare that there's going to be some fervent, effectual prayers going to come out of this house, and some lives are going to be changed and spared because of your prayers in Jesus' name. Look what it says here, Isaiah 59, 19. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the what? Sun. Look what it says there. And when the enemy, you need to circle the word enemy, when the enemy, the what? Enemy. Shall come in like a what? Sun. The Spirit of the Lord shall raise up a standard against him. Is that what it says?
Yes.
But listen to me. Punctuation is not divinely inspired. The scripture is divinely inspired, but the punctuation is not. So what they did is they put the punctuation after flood. Did you see that? When it says when the enemy comes in like a flood. No, I think I'm just as anointed and inspired as those that did this here. So if we put the punctuation behind in, so when the enemy comes in, and he does, then it, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. When he comes in, because you're who you are, and because you're standing in righteousness, then the Lord will raise, when he comes in, the Lord will raise up like a flood and cause a defeat of your enemy in Jesus' name. That's what I'm agreeing with. Look at verse 16. Look at verse 16, the same chapter, verse 16. And it says, and he saw that there was no what? We should put brackets around no man or no woman, homo sapien, among a man or woman, and wondered, there was no what? Intercessor. And that there was also no intercessor. Put brackets around no intercessor. Therefore, his arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness is sustaining him. But he says here, there was no man or no woman, and then he said, or no intercessor. Listen to me. Something happens when you pray for somebody else. Something happens on the behalf of your life and your family when you pray for somebody else's family. And I'm not just talking about prayer. I'm not just talking about no little popcorn prayer. No, bless all the families. Bless the pastor. No. I'm talking about intercession. Where did I take on a position? Look with me in Ezekiel. Look with me in Ezekiel, the 22nd chapter. Ezekiel 22. Somewhere where you take on a position that I'm not going to back down until I see the deliverance come. Woo hoo hoo. Can I just say that one more time on this side over here? Since y'all seem so happy over here. Can I say it one more time over here? I'm not backing down until I see the deliverance come. And that, see, intercession is that I'm going to pray for you until you get your breakthrough.
Amen.
I'm going to pray for you until you get your miracle.
Yeah.
I'm going to stand in the gap for you until you get it. Ezekiel 22, put it on the screen in verse 30. Ezekiel 22 and verse 30. Put it on the screen for me. Don't worry, you got to come to the place where you not recognize that the enemy is doing everything he can to try to stop you from being able to get it. But see, sometimes you can't just do this on your own. You need some help. Push your neighbor and say, I need help. Look what it says. It says, and I sought for a man among them that would make up the hedge. The word hedge there, if you want to put it down in there, it means barrier, a boundary, a wall, a protected area that would make up the hedge. Sometimes making up a hedge or building a wall is brick by brick. You got to take out some time to build that thing. So sometimes Christians don't realize that when they're going to pray for somebody, it takes a little more time to get that deliverance that they need. But they need you to get in there and stand and help them to fight the battle. I wish I had somebody understand what I'm talking about. Come on. Come here, you guys. Come here. So listen to me. One on one side. There you go. So we're going to make this guy. And I'm not saying he is, okay? Because people try to take so many things I say wrong. I'm just saying today, for this couple minutes, we're going to call him God. He ain't God. He's just standing there acting like, because I told him that he's God right now, okay? Okay? And this is y'all. Now, he ain't y'all, but he's standing in the place of y'all. You going through marital problems, you going through children problems, you going through physical problems, you going through financial problems, whatever you going through, that's you right here. But see, you going through some things and sometimes you get overwhelmed. You're overwhelmed like our caustic Christians, like a lot of the other ones around the world that are being overwhelmed. All of a sudden, everything was all right. And now all of a sudden people come into your house and raid your house and snatch you out of your house and take everything you have and kill your mom or your daddy or your children right in front of you. Somewhere you're just overwhelmed. This is you right here. God's over here, but see, I'm going to say something that's a little startling for you, but God still needs your help. Because there are things that God can't do, and he can't just come rushing in here and do what he wants to without your prayers. See, your prayers give God the legal right to intervene on the behalf of somebody else. When you pray, things happen. That's why the enemy fights you so hard. That's why he works against you, because if you pray and you're believing, God has got a right to show up on your behalf. Instead of just saying always, this tough what they're going through, ain't that this bad? That this so bad? Shut up and pray. God says, my ears are open to the prayers of the righteous. Something started happening. So now my responsibility, look at it, put it back on the screen again. Listen to me. That will stand in the gap. Look what it says. That should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me, for the land, for the people, for the situation. Stand in the gap for me. Give me a legal right to intervene on their behalf. Ain't that something so-and-so and them going through a divorce? Isn't that bad? Ain't that something bad? So-and-so and them children in jail, went to jail. Ain't that something? So-and-so had a miscarriage. You know, you just running your mouth a little too much in the wrong direction. Somewhere you got to start standing up and say, quit talking about what people are going through and stand in the gap for them and build up the head for them in Jesus' name. Because your mouth and your prayer is a difference maker on the behalf of somebody else. So now I take on my responsibility as a believer. Now my acoustic Christian or my brothers and sisters around the world are being persecuted, murdered, robbed, raped, tortured, all that's going on. And I'm just talking about how bad it is or not even doing that. But somewhere today, I'm believing some of you are going to get a little tired of letting the enemy rob them. Because listen to me, if he's doing it over there, believe me, if we don't stand up now, eventually we're going to be dealing with it over here. So we might as well go ahead and get busy about taking care of business right here, right now. And it's going to start right here in the West. So what we got to do now, is listen to me. As a believer, I got to now be willing to build up the hedge and stand in the gap. All right, I'm in the gap. So what does that mean? I'm joining my faith. My agreement with my brother or with my sister, and now I'm going to be praying and interceding with them. They might be praying and interceding, but I'm praying with them. Our faith together is more than enough for the enemy. But I'm also giving God, and I don't know how, if they're overwhelmed or they're going through it, they can't even talk, they can't even hardly deal with how bad things are, but I'm praying for them. Now the God of more than enough. Now El Shaddai, now the God that's bigger than everything, can show up on the behalf of the people. Now Jehovah Rapha can show up and heal, and he can deliver. Come on, y'all. Jehovah Bel Perazim can break open, something happen for them. God, help us not to talk about how bad things are, and let's start releasing our faith and our agreement with the power of God on their behalf. So I join my faith with my brothers and sisters around the world, and I start coming against every evil, wicked work of the enemy. And now, listen to me, then I turn around and I join hands with God. I'm in the gap. I said, I'm in the gap. I'm where God is and where my brother is, and I'm standing here holding hands with both of them until he gets his miracle. Because he can't do it himself, but he needs his brother. He needs his sister to stand up for them. Then listen to me. Then when I see the breakthrough come, I'm able to bring them back together, and now him and God can do what they gotta do, and I'll find me somebody else and join hands with them until they get their breakthrough. Come on, lift your hands up. Father, thank you for your miracle working power. Come on, get your hands up. Thank you for your miracle working power. On the behalf of my brothers and sisters that are here today, thank you for manifesting yourself in a real and powerful way. Father, we stand in agreement for those that are hurting today. We stand in agreement for those that are bound today. We stand in agreement for those that are in prison today. We stand in agreement with all those that have been restricted and limited and hindered in their faith, in their forward progress. God, that you will be the God of more than enough. Help us to stand in the gap. Help us to be a difference maker. Help us to release your power on the behalf of my brothers and sisters around the world. In Jesus' name, join your neighbor next to you by the hand and start praying for your neighbor. Come on, join the hand real quickly. Join your neighbor's hand. Father, we lift up. Come on. I pray for my neighbor, for whatever they're dealing with, for whatever they're going through. Whatever it is, the breakthrough that they need, the healing, the deliverance, the manifestation of your glory. I pray, Father, that you would manifest yourself. I intercede. I stand in the gap for my brother and my sister today. And I say that no weapon formed against them shall prosper. declare they are the healed. I declare that they are the whole. I declare that they are the blessed. I declare the glory of the Lord has risen upon them this day, right now, in the name of Jesus. The glory of the Lord, the glory has risen. Thank you for it now, Father. Come on, thank you for it now. Father, thank you for your miracle working power on the behalf of everyone in here today. To whatever they're dealing with, thank you for their deliverance. And then thank you for using them to be a deliverer. In Jesus' name. Have a seat. Have a seat. Listen to me. Catch this here. Turn to your neighbor and say, you better catch this one. Listen to me. When you start having a burden or having a concern, compassion for those that are hurting, when you have that compassion and you start interceding and praying for those that are hurting, listen to me, you can't do it without God reciprocating back to you. I truly believe that a lot of people have not gotten answers to prayers, have ever gotten miracles or manifestation in their life because they have never really taken out the time to intercede for somebody else. They have never sown the seed of intercession. They want a breakthrough, they want a blessing, but they don't understand it's what you make happen for somebody else. God makes happen for you. When you make it happen for somebody else, I'm willing to carry your burden. I'm willing to carry your pain. I'm willing to do what I can to help you. God says, I got to make it happen for you now. Because you're special. You're not like the rest of them. Just talk a little bit. But you're somebody special because you're trying to help make a difference in somebody else. And we never really know the pain that other people are dealing with and what they're going through. But when we can be sensitive to feel the Spirit of God and the love of God to help somebody, everything changes. God help us. Come on, for those that got their hands up, Lord, help the ones that got their hands. Help us to have a spirit of discernment and a spirit of sensitivity. Come on, a spirit of compassion like we have never had before. Release your compassion. Release your love. Release your power. Release your glory. Upon everyone in here. That Father, when they do go through something, because they've been praying for somebody else, thank you for your miracle working power intervening and manifesting on their behalf. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Yeah, you in a miracle service right now. God's got his hand on your life. Because some of you in here right now, hear me now. There's some of you right now, you're going in the wrong direction. And the Spirit of God is trying to turn you around. And he's trying to, you're doubting. You've been doubting him in some area. And he said, I'm trying to reveal myself to you. I'm giving you some keys of how you can see me and know who I am. But it ain't gonna happen on the way you've been doing it. God gave us some weapons. The blood of Jesus. Somebody say, thank God for the blood. How many know there's power in the blood? Wonder working power. No enemy can stand against the what? The blood. We got the blood. Amen. Thank God for the blood. Listen to me. We got the word. Come on. The word of God. The word of God. God watches over his word to perform. When you got the blood, the word, listen to me, and you got your testimony. Not your testimony, not your testimony of defeat, not your testimony of weakness, but your testimony of victory. Yeah. to testify what God has done for you. You got the Spirit to help you and assist you to come alongside. And you got the name of
Jesus.
Come on. The name that is above every name.
Yes.
There's power in the name. There's no greater name than the name of
Jesus.
At the name of Jesus, every knee is going to have to, and every tongue is going to have to confess. God has given you some weapons that you can use to help your brothers and sisters out. That when you give to somebody else, your time of prayer and intercession, God turns around and pours it back into you. Amen, amen, amen. Father, I pray for these men and women here today, never to be the same again. I pray that your hand would be upon them to manifest yourself in their family, in their businesses, in their interpersonal relationships, in their every endeavor to pursue their destiny and your purpose for their life. Thank you for it now, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for your miracle working power. To do the unusual. The unusual. Something that has never happened on their behalf, in their family, because they commit themselves to helping somebody else by being a prayer warrior, an intercessor on the behalf of somebody else.
Again, you know, thank God for the word and for what you've heard, and I'm believing that your life has been enriched through what you've heard, but now you need to make the next step, and that is accept Christ into your life. Won't you say this with me right now? Say, Lord Jesus, I open the door to my heart. I confess with my mouth. I believe in my heart that you died for me and you rose for me, and I receive you as my Lord and as my Savior. If you just did that, Christ is in your life. Heaven is rejoicing over you. I'm rejoicing with you. Please let me know that you did that. And we've got a free book we'd like to give you. Email us, write us, call us, whatever way you got to do it. And I'm praying that you'll find a good local church to grow in and make that commitment. Love you. Looking forward to seeing you next time. Remember this, that the word works when you work the word.
Subscribe to us on YouTube and see the latest videos from Drs. Philip and Brenda Godeau. It's easy.
I am the God of more than enough. I am a El Shaddai God. I'll bring you back and then I'll lift you up.
Just log on to YouTube and type in Philip Godeau Ministries and then just click subscribe. The video messages are right there on your screen. And if you're out and about, we also have a smartphone app so you can catch the Godeaus on the go. The app is easy to find. Just search Calvary Christian Center for both Android and iPhone users. Stay informed, stay connected, and stay encouraged on YouTube and with our amazing app. Hey parents, it's back to Sunday school time. Kingdom Kids is now recruiting. All of us have a special memory from our days at Sunday school as young kids. Help make some new memories for your kids through Sunday school. And remember Ephesians 6 and 8? Whatever good anyone does, he will receive the same. Be a blessing today. See you there.
We declare that a needle will not die. She will live and declare the works of the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Just in the neighborhood, praying for our city.
Learn how to reach others during our next Witnessing Institute. You'll learn how easy it is to share Christ in a non-confrontational and loving way.
So we lift them up unto you, Lord Father, and we ask you to heal their land.
I'm Denise. We're from Calvary Christian Center.
You met some?
Okay. Did they pray for you?
Yep, I got a card and everything.
All right. Very good.
It's part of the Great Commission for us to share the gospel with family, friends, neighbors, co-workers, or even complete strangers.
All right. All right.
What do I need to pray for you?
For my kidneys and for my
stroke and for my health.
Sharing the love of Christ can be intimidating to some, but it's easier than you think. Sign up for our Witnessing Institute today. See you there.
Well, get ready. Calvary Christian Center's annual fishing derby is right around the corner. It's happening September 3rd and 4th of this year. And we've got some pictures to prove it. It's happening at the B&W Resort and Marina at 964 Brennan Isle Road, Isleton, California. Join us for some fishing, food, fun, and of course, a lot of fellowship. On Thursday, we got a cookout taking place. Friday is the big derby day. It's Calvary Christian Center's annual fishing derby.
We are making a difference in our community. Don't forget, you can always learn more about us on the web.
For the very latest ministry updates and news, and to continue the conversation, you can find us on Facebook.
So come on, turn on your smartphone and tweet and post.
Once again, welcome to Calvary Christian Center. We want to remind you, you are participating in a live broadcast that will be seen around the world. Welcome to Calvary Christian Center.